Hi everyone, my name is Alex Purnomo. I'm the pastor of Dunside Anglican Church. How do we relate to unbelievers? The Apostle Paul said in his second letter to the Christians in the city of Corinth that they are to distance and separate themselves from unbelievers. When or in what context are we supposed to do that? And when are we not supposed to do that? I answered this to some extent in my previous video, but I would just like to unpack that a little bit more by looking at the background of Paul's letter and looking at some more practical examples. My goal is that we understand and apply this passage wisely. This is video number 15 in my current series on Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. If you haven't watched the previous video, video number 14, please stop now and watch that video first. In this video, I would assume that you already watched the previous video. Regarding how we relate to unbelievers, we have two commands from Paul that seem to contradict each other. We can find them in the two letters to the church in Corinth that have been preserved for us in the Bible. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, Paul says, "Do not be yoked together with unbelievers." And later in verse 17, he says, "Therefore, come out from them and be separate." But in 1 Corinthians in chapter 5, verse 9, Paul says, "I wrote to you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people." Not at all meaning the people of this world who are immoral, or the greedy and swindlers or idolaters. In that case, you would have to leave this world. But now, I'm writing to you that you must not associate with anyone who claims to be a brother or sister, but is sexually immoral or greedy, an idolater or a slanderer, a drunkard or swindler. Do not even eat with such people. In 2 Corinthians, Paul seems to say that we must be very vigilant lest we be involved with unbelievers in wrong ways. But in 1 Corinthians, Paul seems to say that you must not take that to an extreme. So at first glance, these two commands from Paul seem to contradict each other. But do they? Both letters were written by the Apostle Paul and written to the same church. But there was a period of about a year between the two letters. The circumstances in which Paul wrote the first letter were different from when he wrote the second letter. For example, in the first letter, Paul can still bank on the fact that the Corinthians recognize him as their founder, as a legitimate apostle. The focus of Paul's arguments in the first letter is on the Corinthians and their behavior, not on his own legitimacy. The problems that the first letter addresses are essentially within the church, not between the church and the apostle. By the time of the second letter, however, Paul's opponents had arrived from outside Corinth, preaching a view of Christ and the Spirit that the Corinthians wanted to hear, but which contradicted the gospel that Paul preached. It's a false gospel. Sadly, some people in the Corinthian church accepted this false gospel and turned against Paul. And therefore, by the time Paul writes the second letter, some Corinthians no longer recognized him as a legitimate apostle. As a result, whereas in the first letter we see Paul the pastor striving to fill in the cracks in the Corinthians' way of life, as it were. In the second letter, we see Paul defending and fighting for the legitimacy of his own ministry as an apostle who preaches the true gospel. He calls those who have accepted the false gospel to repent. Some have repented, but some have not. In chapter 6 of the second letter, Paul specifically calls the repentant to separate from the unbelievers in their midst, namely those false teachers and those who fall for their false gospel. Understanding the different circumstances is important in order to understand the two commands of Paul as to how we are to relate to unbelievers. If we understand the different circumstances in which they were given, we see that the two commands don't actually contradict each other. In both commands, Paul tells us not to associate with unbelievers in the sense of people who claim to be a Christian but who have adopted the moral standards of the world. But in 2 Corinthians, there is a greater sense of urgency because such unbelievers are not just members of the church, but they assume positions of influence and authority as preachers or teachers in the church. In the 1 Corinthians 5 passage, Paul is talking about relationships between believers and unbelievers outside the church. But in 2 Corinthians 6, his focus is on separation from unbelievers who are seeking to divide the church from within. I hope you see the two commands don't actually contradict each other. They address two different situations. As I mentioned briefly in my previous video, we could summarize Paul's teaching in a way that is in harmony with the teaching of the Lord Jesus. On the one hand, Don't avoid relationships where you can have clear testimony to the truth and where you are allowed to stand on Christian principles. Paul is not calling us to create a Christian ghetto, as if Christians should do business only with Christians, live only in Christian neighborhoods, eat only with Christians in Christian restaurants, play only on Christian sports teams, and go only to Christian schools. These are all secondary associations that are not even available in most places of the world and do not necessarily define our primary identity as a member of God's people. Whether it is membership in the local sports club or a neighborhood knitting group or a working relationship where the boss is an unbeliever, if you can influence others for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ, you should keep such relationships. You should do so even if you are sometimes criticized for getting too close. Jesus himself was criticized like that, remember? And he was called a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of sinners. On the other hand, we should seriously consider avoiding relationships with people who claim to be a Christian but are teaching a false gospel, a false Jesus, or a false Holy Spirit. If you want examples of some of the biggest false teachers in our day, I highly recommend watching the documentary, The American Gospel, Christ Alone. Please follow the links in the description below this video. We should also seriously consider avoiding relationships with people who claim to be a Christian but have adopted the moral standards of the world. Paul says, "But now I am writing to you that you must not associate with anyone who claims to be a brother or sister but is sexually immoral or greedy, an idolater or slanderer, a drunkard or swindler. Do not even eat with such people." I take this to mean that if a person has been disciplined or warned in the appropriate way and still presses on in their error, we are not to go on socializing with them as if nothing were wrong. We are to say to them, "As long as you pursue this sinful lifestyle, I can't act as if things were normal. I don't think we should get together anymore until you change your ways. Otherwise, it looks as if nothing is at stake." When we do this, it may lead to division within the church or within the denomination. We can see an example of this in what has been happening in the Anglican churches worldwide. Over time, it may lead to the creation of new Christian denominations, and that is not necessarily wrong. Division, for the sake of maintaining the purity of the gospel, is sometimes necessary and right in order that the truth may be vindicated. How do we apply this to dating or marriage? As I said in my previous video, Paul's command to not be yoked together with unbelievers is not primarily about dating or marriage. The command can only be applied to dating and marriage when a person is single or not married. There are strong reasons for this. If your partner doesn't share your Christian faith, then he or she doesn't truly understand it as you do, from the inside. And if Jesus is central to you, then that means that your partner doesn't truly understand you. He or she doesn't understand the mainspring of your life, the ground motive of all you do. It also seems clear to me from elsewhere in the Bible, including 1 Corinthians chapter 7, for example, that ideally, Christians are to date or marry Christians only. But there are some cases where Paul's command to not be yoked together with unbelievers cannot be applied to marriage. For example, if A and B were fully married when they were both unbelievers, and then one of them became a Christian, we would not say that this means they should break up. Paul never applies the command to not be yoked together with unbelievers to break up a marriage that is already in place. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, Paul explicitly tells the Christian partner in such cases not to leave. Indeed, the Christian spouse is to be exemplary in conduct and grace in the hope of winning over his or her family. We need to carefully and prayerfully consider each situation and seek godly wisdom before we apply this verse to dating or marriage. Things in life are often messy and not ideal, and this passage in 2 Corinthians is not primarily about dating or marriage. If you want to reflect more on wisdom in dealing with messy situations related to dating or marriage, please follow the links to a few resources that I have found helpful in the description below this video. If you find this video helpful, please like or subscribe to our channel. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.